good evening. This is Sarah Chiu, the programmer's Basket Starfish, and this is the 58th episode. Again, if you miss any of those, you want to understand more what I talked about, please, you know, type the program name in YouTube. You can watch all the rest, you know, and this research has been on for more than 20 years, and I am actually doing a lot of the comparison between ancient Sumerian pictograph and ancient Egyptian hieroglyph and Chinese oracle bones. But the sound I base on is not Mandarin Chinese, because comparatively Mandarin Chinese are a little bit more mutated. So I actually use Cantonese dialect, and Cantonese dialect is a very ancient Southern dialect, which I believe hasn't mutated as much as Mandarin. So by using it, I can actually compare the same sound with all those ancient systems. So what I'm trying to prove is that we are all the same family from one single core. We are not coming from different family trees, okay? And the old belief of what we coming from a different family tree should be changed, okay? So now let me play this week's slides from the beginning. Yeah, here it is. I want to let you see the basket starfish. This is the core. This is the best I can find in nature. The best thing is to think about it, you know, coming out from a core, but coming out, all these branches should be coming out 360 degrees in all directions. That should be a better, you know, image of what I try to present. But now, since I cannot computer generate an image for you, so this is the best I can find. Okay, so I don't believe that we are all different family tree. We started at the same time from a single core. So looking at us as a different family tree coming out at different time actually usher in human hierarchy. So I think this needs to be changed, and I'm presenting to you an Asian female point of view, and my view can be a little bit different from the academic world. So I hope you can bear with me, because I collect all this information by my more than 30 years of traveling around. Okay, so this week I'm going to talk a little bit about whether it's a cognate or a coincident, because a lot of the time when you present something very similar, they always think that they always say that it is just a coincident. But I will show you again and again why are these things so similar in meaning and in form. First of all, repeat what I have been doing for the last couple of weeks, the T form, and you know, in the image of a tongue, you can actually go back to Sumerian. You can see that they stylized the head, and this is the tongue they want to present, and this is an Akkadian. And these are all in the Mesopotamian area, okay? And this is also the tongue. Look at the T shape. And this is the Chinese writing. And then, although it also means that, you know, something coming out of the mouth. And once again, this is also a Chinese word. And it, from here, it begins to talk about speech, okay? This is the tongue actually become a curve, and it become the concept of the wind coming out of the mouth. And exactly as the Bible said, you know, when first God created this world, and it is by blowing out the spirit, and that life becomes, okay? And that also goes back to the ancient Sumerian, because for them this is a very ancient sign, shows a metaphysic energy that create existence. So basically they are the same thing, okay? And then I want to also show you, because of the tongue, and there is another branch coming now. These are Chinese writing. These are different form when the Chinese are showing the tongue also. Look at this frog tongue, because the snake at the beginning was a very positive sign because of its fertility. If you pay attention to the snake, you know, they give birth much more than human being, you know. They give birth to 30 to 100 eggs, you know, at the time. So you can see that it was a very, very ancient fertility symbol. But as time went by, it was vilified the same way as the female was vilified. So you pay attention that we use this frog tongue as a representation of the tongue, the ability to speak well, okay? So the other way is that as time went by, because it's vilified, this is not a very positive sign. And you will see that if I compare it to the Greek alphabet, for some reason this two alphabet actually leads, you know, as a visual sign for the ancient Greek word glossa, which also means the tongue. So whether this is put there as a visual symbol or it was actually read into the sound glossa is for us to decide, okay? And also, you know, you will see that this is also Greek alphabets, okay? And from this alphabet, you get a lot of like psalm, P-S-A-L-M, okay? And the singing coming out of the mouth, or you also get the word sodo, which is lie, which also goes back to the Chinese writing of this, you know, for us, the tongue also sometimes carry a negative meaning of you accuse someone wrongly. So basically, there is some similarity in their right, in their meaning. And then also from this sign, you know, you can look at it as all different languages, because it exists in Sumerian, it exists in Chinese. And also from here, this is a Chinese sign, it shows itself as some custom that coming from the or rules that coming from above that became a canon that the Chinese had to follow. So if you go to this, you know, ignoring all the form, just take it as a Latin alphabet T, you will see, understand why the word tell and the tongue and the Torah all start with the T, because this is something actually falling down from above, you know, that we have to follow like a road, okay? So again, you know, I have talked a little bit about the natural sound and concept shifting, which is our human mind's versatility and flexibility. Our flexibility in the mind is really amazing. We can cross a lot of borders, you know, but our writing doesn't catch up with it. So as I said, you know, you look at this form, you can look at it as a heart sign, like a T form, or you can look at it as tongue, or you look at it as something coming down, or you can look at it as a turning point. So, but then if you look at it as turning point, you can also write it in different manner. Also like this, they can also be turning. So that's why, you know, it become really the T, the tau of the Phoenician, which become the Latin T, okay? So, and also, you know, in order to write the turning point, the ancient also used this method. Of course, you know, it become, you know, a lot of our ancient concepts. And first of all, you will see that it all the time it represent a W2, so it's a really a whirling movement, or it can mean a tour or a tower. A tower, you know, which you don't really get the direct meaning. That why is it a tower? Because the stairs inside is actually swirling around like that. That's why it gets the name for tower. Okay, if you go to an ancient tower, and you will see that the stairway is really going up like this. So this is a very little bit indirect, okay? And then the other one is dodo, the T and the D also interchange as a sound shifting, but then as a concept, the dodo is really like, you know, whirling around, touring around. And then the other one, you know, you can look at it as an R, it's a round thing because you are drawing a curve. But then they are not simple concept. They are real writing in ancient time. This is this is Hebrew. This is ancient Egyptian hieroglyph. This is Chinese W. This is the R, which nowadays you write it like a P form, you know. This is an R in Greek, okay? So all these were actually become real writing. And then in reality, you know, either than the visual shifting, the concept shifting, you have to pay attention to the sound shifting too, because if this stand for B or P, it will burr. We will be shifting to ver easily, from ver to ver to ver to ra. So all these, they can be shifted very, very easily. It's not limited by our writing. So our present modern idea of the very steady, you know, writing, that they are very, very stable, is not correct. Because in ancient time, you know, even nowadays, if I go to China, in different area, the same word in an area, I can hear V sound. The other area, I will hear a V F sound. So we existed at the same time, just in different regions geographically. Okay, so I also compared to this, this is the one sound in Chinese. You will see that, it also have this curved sound symbol right there. And then of course you can understand as the wind, and the wind is actually the word. So you'll understand why all these were leading, even the English word. So a lot of the words in this world, the writing system, were actually visual from the very beginning. They were not just alphabet as you think they are. A lot of the things actually came down with a visual history, okay? So again, it is this week's talk about coincidence. So I'll give you this writing right there. This is a Chinese writing. The sound is sok, okay? Sok means to lodging station, to stay overnight where you sleep, okay? So, but the same word, when we add a little rope right there, and then it will mean to draw in, to draw back, to recoil. Of course, you tie yourself in, right? To restrain something, to coil back, and to contract back to your own shell, okay? Actually, when we were describing, when we are describing the shell contracting into back their own shell, we actually use this soap right there. But by the visual writing, we understand we are talking about contract, restraint, or we are talking about the sleeping and the lodging, okay? So Chinese are still very visual, but I want you to pay attention to the sound now. This both sok, okay? And I give you a Hebrew word. This is sok. Sok is a hut, a booth, a tent. Look at this, the picture. It seems that the Chinese picture is explaining a Hebrew word, okay? And then I give you better proof. This is sok, and they add another vowel in between. The sok is actually go back, turn back, hatch in. Exactly the Chinese sok meaning. So I don't know whether you listen to it as a Hebrew word or you listen to it as a Cantonese word. So that's what I say. We started at the same time. A lot of the ancient words were actually identical. As long as they are monosyllable, it is very easy to find cognates, So I believe that they are cognate. I believe that they are not coincidence. And once again, the Jewish people need to distinguish visually in their own culture. So they use another S word. This is also soak, and pay attention to this C is actually S, okay? This is not the modern scholar need to visually distinguish the words, so they write them differently. But this is soak, this is also soak, okay? The soak is also hatch in, hem in, also to retreat, to retract. You see, this is exactly the same meaning. So I'm sure the Jewish people visually distinguished it in the same way like the Chinese distinguish our system. As long as you live under one culture, it is very easy for you to adapt to that certain culture. The point is that we started all this work, since very ancient time at the same time, okay? So, of course, you know the Sukkot word. The Sukkot is actually the plural of Sok, and this word, Sukkot is the first campsite the Israeli left when the Israeli left Egypt. So you can imagine that they pitched tents, for the first night of sleep. It become a tent city when they moved around. So this become the Sukkot, the word Sukkot, and until now they still celebrate the Sukkot, every year. And then if you look to the Arabic word, you have exactly the same sound, souk. Souk is actually the market. Why? But then it has seems to have a different meaning. But if you pay attention, when I lived in very remote places, whenever you see a tent city, temporarily, that means it's a market. The people travel from afar, they need a place to stay in to sell their product. So it actually become a market, but it's also the place where they is a lodging station where they stay overnight. So actually the meaning are all the same, It's only that the English word make us confused that they are different thing. Okay, so I go on to the next slide. I will ask you whether again this is a coincidence. Look at this Chinese word. You will see that a hand is coming from behind, grabbing the leg, the heel of a person in front, okay? So in Cantonese pronunciation, this is gap or cup, okay? Or gap or cup, okay? And this cup Look at this. The meaning is extend to, reach to, coming up to, and it always has a subtle meaning from behind. The meaning never said behind, but as a Chinese, we always understand when we mention this word cup, it's always mentioned something from behind, okay? And look at this, the word Jacob, okay? And then Jacob, you know the story in the Bible, Jacob, the name, it comes from this root, you know, a cup. Cup is the meaning of hill, and then when they put, you know, an action verb right there, in a cup, it actually means, you know, to reach from behind, to supplant, to circumvent, to overreach. You know the story that Jacob grabbed the heel of Esau, his brother, his twin brother. He's actually the firstborn, but he actually supplanted his own brother. So he actually reached from behind and supplanted his own brother. And supposedly he has to follow. He was the one to be behind, but he actually got in front, you know, because of his action. So the word become depend on how you read it. When you stress more in the action, become Jacob and become the word Jacob. Okay, the Jacob. You look at this. If you pay attention to the sound itself, become the Latin word captus. You know this is cup and cup and cup. Okay, the captus, of course, it means catch, to capture, and to stop someone. And Jacob is actually stopping his own brother and become, you know, and he took the birthright and become the patriarch of the Jewish people. So you will see that why is it that is the Chinese picture again seem to explain the sound of a Jewish word? Again, is this coincidence? Okay. Again, I want you to pay attention to this. If I use this this wood root as, you know, to show you one very interesting thing. A while ago, I showed you this eye. You can also look at it as the narrow part, the pubic triangle of the female, because it has link, you know, to the eye, you know, to the fountain, to the source. But in this case, you know, you should look at it as the hand, okay? Because the ancient actually jam a lot of things together. There's a multiple meaning to one word, so never get to the modern custom of everything has only one answer. No, every single symbol has multiple meaning and multiple direction of development, okay? So you, in this case, you should look at it as like a hand, okay? And this cup right there, and then look at it. I will compare it to other Hebrew word. You will see this is a jar. Look at this, you know, but I will, you will understand it later. But this is a Chinese word right there. For us, it become developed into this and then become a Chinese word. This actually, you know, has the meaning of to hold on to something, to jia something, okay? And to do with the hand. And then it seems that it is telling the story in the Bible as first at the beginning, and then to hold tight, to squeeze. You know, this is what Jacob was doing using his hand. And then, yeah, and it also has a very negative meaning of the killing of the shrub and the trees. And that's the killing the family tree of someone else, okay, to stop, to haunt. And then when you look at the Chinese dictionary for this meaning, it actually points you to another word meaning to be lost and to escape. Of course, you know, the birthright of Esau was lost, and then he was forgotten from the family tree, and then Jacob took over, and then the word also become, you know, the forgotten and disappear and dead, because for the ancient, what is not seen is being forgotten, is dead, okay? So even in Chinese, this word are actually lingering between to forget and death, okay? So if I work it back, you will see that how confusing words can be. And you will see that this word, you know, through thousands of years of history, there was a time they can actually be confused very easily. But if I look at the very origin, you know, it's a form like this. It's actually a human being hide behind a corner. But I actually, if you look at that, I actually found a cognate in ancient Egyptian hieroglyph. This is how the ancient Egyptian hieroglyph to express forgotten, forget, and death. Okay? okay? And the sound is actually exactly carrying the M sound, mong in Chinese. It also carry the meaning of memory and the mort, the death. And if that's what I'm saying, that even in ancient Egyptian hieroglyph, the sound M and N, the Chinese M and N, and the memory and the mort, they were all cognate in all languages in the history. So you will see that, you know, by comparing all these ancient pictures, you can actually find a lot of details of the ancient beliefs. Okay, again, if you look at this, at the hand as the tight space, you will see that they actually carry some sound. In Hebrew, it actually is the ayin, which in Jacob, it doesn't really have a sound, but then it in this, it actually has a da sound, okay? And you will see that sometimes you can actually look at it as a narrow space, like a hand, okay? And I compare this to the Chinese, and again, this has a da or za sound, okay? This is very, very close to what the za did in Hebrew. For us, it actually means to squeeze, to hold tight, or something very narrow. And then if I put these two Hebrew symbol together, it actually form a word etzer. Etzer actually has this kind of meaning, narrowness, and which the Chinese word also carry, and it actually means squeeze and pressure. The Chinese word also carry, but it's a, okay, and then also carry the oil and juice, and this become the Chinese verb, you know, to mean squeeze of oil, okay, and then because of the squeezing action, and it actually becomes the birth or action of the female, because you have to squeeze the baby out. So sometimes it can be very cross boundary to very different area, and because of this narrowness, it also gets to oppression, restriction. The same happened in the Chinese da and za, and then it also means to work, and then become a forced labor, okay? And as I said, you know, I don't want you to argue that no, this is an ein, and I also, that's why I also show you the other linkage, you know, this S has to do with the eye, the valley, the narrow place of the female, okay? So because the vilification of the female, you know, even though the female give birth to children, and also this word will be used, you know, again and again for very negative meaning. And whenever you see this sign, a lot of the time they were actually negative words in Hebrew. And I mean, if you're Hebrew, if you're Jewish people, you will understand what I am saying. A lot of this symbol were used to mean something negative. This is what the patriarch has been doing to vilify the female. Okay, so once again, compared to that word, even to the English called as, this is as, is means oppression. This is what I want to show you right there by a Chinese word. This is like a clam of the hen. This is the da in Chinese, and it actually means to stop, to haunt, to squeeze, and to grasp tight something, and some place narrow and tight. And then the Chinese actually have a verb called at. Za exactly sounds like the Hebrew za, and for us atza, it means oppression. So exactly like this coas, okay? And again, this is Hebrew atza. And if I turn it around, the Chinese actually, you know, has a lot of attention paid to this clam right there. And I will explain to you later. But I will show you this word to further prove my theory. This atza means to squeeze tight, exactly like the za in Chinese, the midrine. This is a very special Hebrew word meaning Egypt. And what is it that it means? And you will see that, you know, the za sound is right there, okay? If you look up the dictionary, it can mean too narrow strip of land. Of course, you know, this is in between in between flows the Nile River. So this is only two very, very narrow strips. But because the Jewish people spent more than 400 years being there, being a slave, can it be that they actually subtly call it a land of the coercion? So not to offend their master, so they just use this word, you know, so they have a double meaning, you know, so they can express themselves. This is also one of my suggestions, okay? So I also pull out a lot of ancient Sumerian pictograph. Can you see all this? They either carry the sound er, or it carried the sound z or s or su. This is a shifting sound, okay? You will see that either it is a, like a cram, the pressure pressing down, something flowing down from here, or it used a lot of pressure. I actually saw a lot of this oil press or the press for the days. They actually pile bags and bags of cement over, and then they to use the squeeze the days to get the juice out. So, or they actually run a piece of cloth to squeeze all the juices out. So you can actually see them in reality, you know, if you live, you know, in those places, okay? So, but I want to show you this very interesting sign, this interesting sign that the Chinese continue to use. For us, it means the jaw of the tiger. In medical term, in Chinese, this is called also called the jaw of the tiger, interestingly. And this is the word in tiger in Chinese, but it actually pun with the word, you know, pain and suffering. And then you see also this sign. For us, this is an ancient station for pressing of oil, and this word also pun with the word of labor. So you will see that they subtly, you know, put in the ancient slavery, and then the pain that they suffer in ancient time by expressing the pressure they feel in ancient time, okay? So I will go in one more. I ask, is it more coincidence, the way and the path, okay? And because in the Bible, you will see that the Jesus said, the Thomas asked, you know, how can we know the way? And Jesus answered that I am the way, the truth, and the life, okay? And this is what you see, the ancient icon, but I will show you quickly a few ancient symbol right there. These are all ancient symbol. This is ancient pictograph, Sumerian. This is Sumerian cuneiform. This is Akkadian. This is Chinese, all meaning the role, the center, the hub, where the pivot is. Okay, so I think I will stop here because our time is running out. I am sorry, I have to go very fast. Please type the name Basket Starfish. This is the 58th episode. You can watch the episode again. And once again, you will see that why I say that we all started from one ancient core. Okay, thank you for watching.